Welcome back to The Discourse, where opinions are aired in good faith. Once again, I have to tell you, urge you, implore you to subscribe to this YouTube channel, and that simple click will cause all your anxieties and fears to melt away. Jane Campion's first feature film for more than 10 years is out now in cinemas, a Western Gothic psychodrama called The Power of the Dog, adapted from the 1967 novel by Thomas Savage. It stars Benedict Cumberbatch, Kirsten Dunst, Jesse Plemons, and Cody Smith McPhee.
25 years since our first run together. 1900 and nothing.
It's a long time.
What you doing?
Getting mixed up with her.
You are marvelous, Rose. We were married Sunday.
Little lady made these.
I did, sir.
Well, Brother Phil?
The Power of the Dog is mysterious, malicious, and it has something that very few films have or wish to have in this era of franchising and IP potential, namely a great ending. The setting is 1920s Montana, and two brothers are running a profitable ranch. The boorish roughneck Phil, played by Benedict Cumberbatch, and his more refined brother George, played by Jesse Plemons, whose fancy ways Phil despises, but he is still utterly dependent on him emotionally, and these grown men share a bedroom like kids. For complex reasons of his own, Phil is enraged when George gets married to a widow in town, Rose, played by Kirsten Dunst, who has a sensitive teen son, Peter, Cody Smith McPhee, and this kid is instantly subject to Phil's homophobic abuse. But then something strange happens. Phil takes what appears to be a fatherly interest in Peter, offers to take him out riding in the remote hills and school him in the ways of manhood, the way he was apparently schooled way back when by an old rancher, now dead, called Bronco Henry. This is a horribly gripping film over which an air of tragedy, horror, and dysfunction hangs, and despite its Western stylings, it sometimes feels like something by Ibsen, especially in the excruciating black tie dinner scene, initiated, of course, by George, at which the guests of honour are the boy's wealthy parents, and poor Rose is so tremblingly miserable that she can't play the piano for them. And of course, Campion fans will enjoy the use of the piano as an occult totem of culture and feminine identity and resistance. It is one of the best films of the year, so go and see it in a real-life cinema.
Yeah.
This is certainly an outstanding week for new releases. I've already vlogged at this year's online Berlinale about Céline Sciamma's exquisite fairy tale reverie Petite Maman, which is out this week and which reminded me of classic English stories about childhood, like Ian McEwan's The Child in Time. I've given a link to that vlog below. Now it's time for a real banger, to use an entirely unfortunate and inappropriate term, Ryu Hamaguchi's film Drive My Car.
Dushita? いや、俺、加福さんと一体何の話してんだろうって。元さんはきっと幸せでしたね。加福さんみたいな人が旦那さんで。どうだろう。もしよかったら、僕に元さんのことを何か話してくれませんか?元のこと?お二人の馴れ初めとか。 どんな風に本を書かれていたのかとか、普段の会話でも何でもいいんです。君はこう考えてる。僕たちは同じ悲しみを共有してる。同じ女を愛したから。そんな、僕のはただの一方的な憧れです。君は音に恋をしていた。
This mysterious and rather beautiful film is inspired by a short story of the same name by Haruki Murakami, and that title, like Murakami's Norwegian Wood, is there to tease us with the shiny wistfulness of a Beatles lyric. Like Hamaguchi's other films, this is about the enigma of identity, the importance of role play in all social interaction, and the erotic rapture of intimacy. Yusuke, played by Hadatoshi Nishijima, is a famous theatre director who has lost his wife and then discovers that she was having an affair with a conceited young actor and celebrity Koji, played by Masaka Okada. Driven perhaps by a need to confront or control him, Yusuke then casts this young man in his production of Uncle Vanya, and the strange duel between these two men coexists with the growing relation that Yusuke has with his personal driver Misaki, played by Toko Miura. All the time, while the alpha male face-off between Yusuke and Koji is taking its course, the driver, Masaki, is growing enigmatically in importance, and in the film's final section, she tells her story, and this does not need to dovetail thematically with anything that has gone before. Its purpose, and the whole film's purpose, is to reflect, again, on the proliferation and unending mystery of other people's lives, and to show us how these lives are complicated and withheld, and that we are being very arrogant if we do not understand this basic human truth. Hamaguchi is a master of these stories. Well, I'm signing off now, and as Christmas will soon be upon us, and you're trying to think of gifts, then why not get your debit card out and buy my book, The Films That Made Me, an edited selection of my essays and reviews for The Guardian. Isn't that a great idea? Be seeing you.